intersection between science and religion. Gives out an award every year.
Templeton,
thank you. Templeton is no longer alive, but his foundation gives out awards to the best writing on the topic of the intersection of science and religion. And John Barrow has won that prize. Now we have a, so there's more here in the lecture notes about fine-tuning, but just be aware, anything you read about fine-tuning, an intelligent people on both sides can debate these issues, and Stenger is a convincing arguer saying, no, the tuning can be fuzzy. The electron charge can be pretty fuzzy and still get life, or the Newton's constant doesn't have to be exactly this number. It could be different, but it would still get life. But it remains an unresolved issue in cosmological science. I want to skip a few of these things. I encourage you to read this on your own. So, multiverses. So, there's, as I say, there's been a resurgence in interest in multiverses. Brian Greene is right in the middle of this. If you are picking a Brian Greene book to read, take a look at the brief summary or a book review and see if it has this topic addressed, because he's very strong on the idea that there's an infinitude of universes. Nothing in, that we know about cosmological science prevents this from happening. And that there's the possibility that some of these universes intersect. And we'll talk about that more in a second. So that there, and there's a list here of different categories, the ones that are numbered in Roman numerals, that there are different ways these multiverses might exist dimensionally and physically. And this is all speculative. So we ought to bring up the point that right now we have no scientific technique for detecting or exploring other universes. So we're going to use the word all capital letters universe, meaning the collection of a multitude of universes. We only know how to explore the one we're in. And then there's the word universe with only a capital U. That's ours. And have we ceased to be doing science if we're talking about universes we cannot visit? We cannot see. We have no tools for exploring. On one hand, the community will say, yeah, that's not science. You're just speculating. On the other hand, you can think back in history, the history of science, and say, was it non-scientific to talk about atoms in ancient Greece? They had no methodology for detecting or characterizing the little chunks of matter that they imagined made up bigger chunks of matter, and ultimately you get grains of sand and pyramids. Were they not scientific when they were speculating about tiny stuff? And you can argue about science. Yes. Yeah, that's right. So the string theory resides on what it can. It's keeping a lot of mathematicians busy. And can it produce a testable result? And this is why it has been pushed in the corner by a lot of mainstream scientists. But it's also true in the history of science, even in the last 100 years. People who push ideas in the corner come to rue the day they did that. The guy, Enrico Fermi, said Casimir is nuts. There's no way two plates put very, very close together actually feel a force between them. And it took 40 years to build an experiment sensitive enough to see it, but I showed you the result. Casimir was right. So we have to be very careful about pushing ideas in the corner. And string theory is really in the corner right now. There are a few people who are enthusiastic about it, but they're exhausted because they've had 35 years to do something, to predict something testable, and it has not happened. So here's the way Brian, this is my version of Brian Greene's idea about things are possible. So I put this little cartoon up because those cartoons are not the same. There's a tiny difference. I only spent a minute looking. Right in this, oh yeah, see that little purple thing right there? It's blue over there. So the reason I put this up is to amuse you and to say that if Brian Greene and his colleagues are right, there's another universe just like this one, where the DNA, because there's an infinite number of universes in their view, so all things are possible. It means this scenario, us in this room, is being repeated in another universe somewhere else. Except, right now, a white dog walks into the room. That's the only difference. And in another universe, everything that's happening is just like what's happening here, except Brad Pitt is the lecturer. Or a guy that looks like Brad Pitt. And his genetics. I mean, you know this story about if you give monkeys typewriters and you wait long enough, you get Macbeth. It would take a long time. But if you invite an infinite number of universes into the room, this might be true. So it's a little, we're definitely over on the other side of the line that says this is science and this is speculation. So I have one more thing that, well, we can keep going for a little bit because I have something I want to show you. Somebody already brought this up, that if there's multiverses, is there a possibility of intersection? Some of a neighboring universe, not neighboring in the sense of distance, but neighboring in the sense of dimension. Is there any way to detect that? And so I put this little sidebar up. I'll put it up again. Gravity is dramatically weaker than any of the other forces we know about. There is an argument that gravity is leakage from another universe that somehow intersects with ours. And this lady, Lisa Randall, is an advocate for this. She is not a crackpot. She's been at Harvard for, I don't know, 25 years. And if you click on that link, you'll see an article about her and this idea in the New York Times. This is mainstream thinking about why is gravity so dramatically different than the other forces of nature that we measure. That could go on the list as an unsolved problem in physics, right? Not just astrophysics, but physics itself, gravity being so weak. And if you add that to the idea that the expansion rate or the dark energy density of the universe is so small, not what we would have expected, then you come face to face with this issue of fine-tuning. These numbers are so just right. By the way, a friend of mine, my wife, I'm going to mention his name, John Miller, used to date this woman.
Oh my.
Yes. She knows John Miller. He's an eccentric. And he could not deal with her. There were some major issues. But she has been to see you, every year the university